be seated. Morning. Welcome to our service of worship on this now glorious Sunday morning. A couple of announcements. You can see there's a bullet announcement in your bulletins about Mario Sassi. I had a chance to visit with him this week, and he's doing amazingly well, even surprising his doctors beyond belief. He says he's feels about 90%. He knows he could resume doing everything he used to do, but he's taking it slow. He's planning to. The day I met with him, it was his first day to actually be driving again. So he was happy to be able to meet me and drive in the car without having a chauffeur. He was looking forward to getting back to leading worship and whatnot, but he's going to take his time and start doing that in November. And he gives thanks to all of us for the prayers we have shared, and to God for keeping him here among us to continue his work and continue his service. So he knows it's a blessing, and he is very thankful of it. So, a reminder that if you wish to help with some of the $26,000 costs of the furnace replacement, you may make special donations on your offering envelopes by marking furnace, or in a plain envelope marked furnace with your offering number, so that it can be directed towards that expense. And this morning, as part of our worship service, we will be installing our newly elected elders from the spring voting. There's an insert that you'll be asked to follow along, because the minister forgot to tell the person making the slides that we were doing it this Sunday, so it's not going to be on the screens. Let us take a moment to quiet our hearts and minds as we prepare to worship God. Let us join in our call to worship responsibly. Sing to the Lord a new song. We will worship God, our Maker. Let us praise God with song and dance, for God is gracious and loving. Let us bring God glory and honor, for God deserves our praise. Our opening hymn, number 324, Great is Thy Faithfulness, 324.
Thank you.
Let us come before God in prayer. God of grace and glory, your creative power is beyond imagining. Your love is wider than the whole universe. Your mercy reached beyond the highest heavens. Your wisdom lies deeper than the fathoms of the sea. Maker of all things, you became one of us in Jesus Christ, walking the roads we take each day. Through your Spirit, you are present with us in every time and place, to comfort, to challenge us. We worship you, Creator, Christ, and Spirit, and will live to bring you glory now and always. God of majesty and mercy, although Christ offers us peace, we confess we are a people divided. We harbor fears and jealousy, which set neighbor against neighbor, nation against nation. We pursue profit and pleasure, which harm creation and the well-being of less privileged peoples. Forgive us, Lord. In silence, Lord, we come before you now, bringing our own confessions for your care. Have mercy upon us, O Lord. Set us free from our old ways to serve you as agents of your reconciling love in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. The Apostle Paul challenges us to lay aside actions and deeds that distance us from God, from one another, and to put on the armor of light. Know that you are forgiven by God's grace. Walk in God's mercy. Be at peace with God, with yourself, and with one another. Amen. Invite our newly elected elders to come forward as we install them. Let's join responsively. There are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are varieties of services, but the same Lord. There are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each one is given a gift by the Spirit, to use it for the common good. Together we are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. Though we have different gifts, together we are called to be the church in a ministry that brings us together. Let us confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed, number 539 in your hymn books and printed on the insert. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As part of the ongoing requirements of our term service for ruling elders, which calls for elections to happen every 2 years, this spring, Jason Bagshaw chose to exit session, while Marcia Guthrie and Vivian Young chose to stand for election. After voting was completed, Marcia and Vivian were re-elected, and Jane Henderson was approached based on votes received and agreed to serve. Therefore, I present to you Marcia Guthrie, Jane Henderson, and Vivian Young to be installed as ruling elders of Community Presbyterian Church. listen to what the Presbyterian Church in Canada believes concerning the ministry of ruling elders. All ministries of the church proceed from and are sustained by the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our prophet, priest, and king. The minister of the covenant by grace, by the operation of God's word and spirit, the church is gathered, equipped, and sent out to participate in this ministry. All members of the church are called to share the gospel with the world and to offer to the Father the worship and service that are due the Creator from creation. Through Christ, the only mediator, until he comes again, that the church may be continually renewed and nurtured for ministry. Christ furnishes the church with pastors and teachers. He requires, enables the church to discern and to confirm by ordination those whom he calls to this pastoral and teaching office. The standards of his church he entrusts in a special degree of responsibility to their care. The form of Presbyterian church government of the Westminster Assembly reminds us that Christ has furnished some in the church, beside the ministers of word, with gifts for government and with commission to execute the same, when called thereunto, who are to join with the minister in the government of the church, with which Reformed churches commonly call elders. The Presbyterian Church in Canada is bound only to Jesus Christ, the church's king and head. The scriptures of the Old and New Testament as written word of God, testifying to Christ the King, the living word, are the canon of all doctrine by which Christ rules our faith and life. We acknowledge our historic continuity with the Holy Catholic Church and our doctrinal heritage in the ecumenical creeds and the confessions of the Reformation. Our subordinate standards are the Westminster Confession of Faith as adopted in 1875 and 1889, the Declaration of Faith concerning Church and Nation of 1954, and Living Faith, Foi Vivante, as adopted in 1998. And such doctrine as the Church in obedience to Scripture and under the promised guidance of the Holy Spirit may yet confess in the Church's continuing function of reformulating the faith. Marcia, Jane, and Vivian, that your faith in God and your integrity of purpose may be declared before God and all people, you are required in terms of this preamble to answer the following questions appointed for all who enter the office as ruling elder. Do you believe in God the Father made known in his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom the Holy Spirit witnesses in the witness of Scripture in the Old and New Testaments? Do you accept the subordinate standards of this church, promising to uphold its doctrine under the continual illumination and correction of the Holy Spirit, speaking in the Scriptures and to be guided thereby in fostering Christian belief, worship, and service among all people? Do you accept the government of this church by sessions, presbyteries, synods, and general assemblies? And do you promise to share in and submit yourself to all lawful oversight therein, and to follow no divisive course, but to seek the peace and unity of Christ among your people and throughout the Holy Catholic Church? In accepting the office of elder, do you promise to perform your duties in the grace and Lord Jesus Christ, striving to build up his church and to strengthen its mission in the world? May the Lord bless you and give you grace to keep these vows. I ask the congregation to please stand. The ordination and admission of elders in a congregation, if their leadership and ministry are to be fruitful, involves responsibilities for both the elders and the people of the church. These questions, therefore, I direct to you, the members and adherents of this congregation, so that you may renew your obligation to this sacred ministry. Do you confess your faith in God as creator and ruler of the world, in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, and in the Holy Spirit as your inspiration and strength? Do you receive Marcia Guthrie, Jane Henderson, and Vivian Young as elders, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead you in the way of Christ? Do you agree to encourage them to respect their decisions as they guide you, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church? May the Lord bless you and give you the grace to keep these promises. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. We praise you and glorify you, Lord God Almighty, for you have created us and called us to yourself, You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ, your Son. You sustain our lives and our works through the presence and power of your Holy Spirit. Almighty God, in every age you have chosen servants to speak your word and to lead your people. We thank you for these women who you have called to serve you as ruling elders. By the power of your Spirit, develop in them the gifts of ministry. May they have the same mind that was in Christ, serving you in the world as long as they shall live, through Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Ask the congregation to please join in the unison prayer. God of grace, who baptized us into a common ministry as ambassadors of Christ, who called us to be a priesthood of all believers, who entrusted to us the message of reconciliation, we pray for courage and discipline to follow where your elders rightly lead us, that together we may declare your mighty acts and show your love to the world, through Jesus Christ, who is ruler of all. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, the only King and Head of the Church, and by the authority invested in me by the Presbytery of Lanark and Renfrew, I now declare you, Marcia Guthrie, Jane Henderson, and Vivian Young, to be part of the session of this congregation. Whatever you do in word or action, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to him always. Amen. Now invite other elders in the congregation to come forth and share the right hand of fellowship. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Just shake hands. Now we can all return to our seats. Gospel box time. All the boys playing hockey? Yeah. So I guess you're going to open the gospel box. Clock, yeah. This morning I want to talk to you about time. Every day we wake up, we have 24 hours, and it's a gift. It's a gift from God that we have every day that we have, every minute that we have. And the reason it's a gift is because it gives us the opportunity to do things that will glorify God and help change the world for the better. We don't know what's going to happen in any given day, but we try our best to share the word of God with others, and to show God's love to all those that we meet. Is that part of what you do every day? And that's what we all try to do. So we have to remember that those days, those minutes, every second is a gift, that we should hang on to that gift and use it the way God intended it for us. Can you do that? Can you help me lead the Lord's a prayer, and then we'll have the Lord's prayer together? Okay, let us pray. Loving God, we appreciate every opportunity we have to be in this world, to share it with others, and share your love wherever we can. Be with us. Give us strength, courage, hope, and grace to meet others who may not know you, and help them learn to love you as we do, as we pray in your name. And now in the words that Jesus taught us, we'll pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Okay, we'll see you later. As we prepare to hear God's word, let us pray. God of word and wisdom, send us your Holy Spirit, so that by your light we may see clearly what you call us to be and to do. Engage us by your truth, so we know how best to follow Christ Jesus, your living word. Amen. Our responsive psalm this morning, Psalm 149, Refrain 1. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, God's praise in the assembly of the faithful. Let Israel be glad in their Maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their ruler. Let them praise God's name with dancing, making melody to the Lord with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people and adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their couches. Let the high praises of God be in their throats and the two-edged swords in their hands to execute vengeance on the nations and punishment on the peoples, to bind their rulers with fetters and their nobles with chains of iron, to execute on them the judgment decreed. This is glory for all God's faithful ones. Praise the Lord.
Praise to the Lord and sing a new song. Amid all the saints, God's praises prolong.
Our scripture lesson today comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 12, verses 1 to 14. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor. Having taken into account the number of people there are, you are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with what each person will eat. The animals you choose must be year-old males without defect, and you may take them from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month. Then all the members of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. That same night they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with the bitter herbs, and bread made without yeast. Do not eat the meat raw or boiled in water, but roast it over a fire, with the head, legs, and internal organs. Do not leave any of it till morning. If some is left till morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it: and your cloak tucked into the belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat, it is the Lord's Passover. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn of both male and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you are to commemorate for the generations to come. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance." For the word of God in scripture, the word of God within us, for the word of God around us. Thanks be to God. Let us join in our hymn 625, "Seek Ye First."
Ooh.
growing up, I think most of us were exposed to the commandments of the Old Testament. There were Sunday school lessons and games to help us understand and memorize them. I suspect we all learned that the first commandment given to the Israelite people by Moses was that you shall have no other gods before me. Some have suggested that this is the most important one of all, regardless of which order they are spoken, when they are used, that one is the top. That commandment is found in Exodus 20, verse 3. Now, I'm not sure who to blame for my confusion on this. Obviously, I didn't pay attention to the rabbis or the biblical scholars when they taught about the commandments of God. Because if that is what we consider to be the first command given by God to the people of Israel, then we have zoomed right past our passage today in Exodus 12, where we actually find the first command to the people. And this command has nothing at all to do with who is the ultimate God for us to worship, but all about keeping time through a calendar. Now, another bit of my confusion this week was that this Exodus passage is also known as the Passover passage, the scripture that is the last of the 10 plagues, where the Bible is telling Israel how to remember God's mighty acts on their behalf. Now, had I paid attention, I would have learned that while this passage is used to remember the first two verses that I read are God giving the people the mitzvah of Rosh Kodesh, the first command. God begins this text talking about a calendar. Moses and Aaron are told, this month is to be for you the first month of your year. The first thing God wanted for people was for them to keep a calendar. Now, this past week receives a lot of attention every year because it is back to school time. And for families, regardless of the age of the children, the start of the new school year is hectic. Well, let me tell you, in churches, community organizations, sports groups, this week on the calendar is every bit as hectic. In fact, this week I stopped entering meetings and events on my calendar because there simply wasn't any more room to fit them into the little squares. But I did attend a few extra things that didn't make it down onto the page. I don't know about you, but keeping my calendar brings with it anxiety. It reminds me what I have to do, what I have done, what I have forgotten to do, who I have loved and who I have failed to love. It reminds me what, fill in your blank, I should have, could have, might have neglected. I am confident I am not alone in this dilemma, and I'm pretty sure none of us wants to hear what God has to say about timekeeping. And maybe it is best that we just leave this passage to be about Passover. Break it all down, about the lamb, the bitter greens, the unleavened bread, how they relate to that last plague. How the last plague involves the death of the firstborn of each family living in Egypt. How God passed over the people of Israel, and how the editor of the book of Exodus interrupted the story to tell the people how these events were to be reenacted. In fact, please tell me that the point of Exodus 12, 1 to 14, especially before a Christian community, that the real point is understanding verses 3 to 14, the ins and outs of a festival for which we are basically unfamiliar. Because then I won't have to go there, to my calendar, to the distinct possibility that God wants me to talk about time. Well, I am going to go there. I'm going to take that plunge and explore verses 1 and 2. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, this month is to be your first month, the first month of your year. This is the first command. This is a gift. God has given the people of Israel and all of us a lunar calendar. In the original Hebrew text, the word used means moon. In the English, it drops an O and adds a TH to the end, and we get month. The month God is speaking about is more accurately a moon that God is pointing us to. Do you see that moon? It will be a full moon, and it will be the first moon of your year. About 10 days or so ago, we were all able to look up and see the supermoon that we heard about. So close, so majestic, wasn't it? So close, we almost felt we could reach out and touch it. It was a new moon, just like the one God was directing Moses and Aaron to use as their marker. Not just for a single time, not for a single holiday. They were asked to lead the people in sanctifying that bright new moon for the rest of time. So from the time of Exodus until the end of the third century, God's people would gather together at the end of one moon. And if you were lucky to see evidence of a new crescent, and then you found a second witness to confirm it, you could make a mad dash to the designated officials who would be asked several questions, and if deemed reliable in your answers, they could announce the next month, and words of blessings would follow. Blessed are you who makes the month holy. Time was given, not a given. Telling time kept people connected to each other and to God. Does it do that for us? Does telling time sync ourselves with our calendars or with God's loving intent? Because long ago, the people of God got more than information from the moon. They also got revelation. They got encouragement. In sanctifying the new moon, they got guidance in sustaining the festivals and celebrations that blessed them spiritually, physically, emotionally. Our spiritual ancestors were made whole by the rhythms they saw from the sky above them. Each time the planet revolved around the sun and the moon around the planet. By keeping the lunar calendar, they saw and received the promise of renewal. They came to know that they and we are like the moon. Our strength, our vitality, our sense of identity, our capacity to make good on that identity will wax surely as it has waned. Our future will brighten. August 21st, 2017 was the last total solar eclipse in North America. There is another one expected in April of 2024. And while there are eclipses several times a year in different parts of the world, many are only partial, only seen in the same place once every 400 or so years. Now, I will admit, I am not a great stargazer. My wife is. But when those rare events happen, I do stop and take a look, often marveling at the immensity of creation, the gift that God has given, the wonder of such amazing experiences. In 2017, we had literally just purchased our cottage, and we had the privilege of sitting on the dock to observe this celestial event, including those silly glasses they tell you to wear to protect your eyes. And afterwards, I saw what you all saw, those pictures from the observatories, the special vantage points across the continent, which were even more spectacular than what my old eyes could acknowledge. It was a time when all kinds of people were gathering together, coming from different places, different times, different experiences, together to experience the moment. And as remarkable as that shadow scenery was on that day, what was even more amazing was how the event acted as a summons to people, to be connected, to be together, gladly, freely. So it is believable then that God was at work in the gifting of a lunar calendar to us, a way for God's people to keep time in this world. It is no more far-fetched to ponder the implications of these two verses in our lives than to search for meaning in the 12 that follow it. If there is something for us to listen for in the institution of Passover, which we as Christians do every Maundy Thursday as we acknowledge Jesus' last meal with his disciples, God is clearly speaking in his command for us to mark the new moon. Of course, we as Christians do not seek to follow all of the laws that exist in the book of Exodus. But here's the thing. We are happy to recite the Ten Commandments. We cherry pick from other parts of that part of the Bible. Why not let that first command bless our living? The good news today is that having heard a sermon on the moon, you now know to add the dates of new moons on your calendar, though I have. The good news is in the memory of a gift. It is in this image of our Creator longing to give us signs that will lead us to meaningful relationships. It is the possibility, the very real possibility, that God is using all kinds of things beyond our understanding to guide and renew us. I can't say what I think you should do, but I can say what I hear reverberating out of Exodus 12, verses 1 and 2, that time is a God thing. The Lord saw that no longer would the Egyptians control the Israelites' calendar, so gave them a new way to tell and to keep time. It is a time for Pharaoh to keep his hands off your calendar, off of your family's calendar, off of your community's calendar. Then with God's help, let us get after it and keep God's time. Amen. The choir will now minister to us with their music.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to
God calls us to show our love through the kindness we offer to our neighbors. Our offerings will spread the gifts God has given us to neighbors in need in the name of Christ our Lord. So now let us bless these gifts left on the plates as we pray for the people and needs of our world. Gracious God, receive these gifts offered in a spirit of generosity and humility. Bless and use them for the work that you long to do in this world, for your love of Jesus' sake. God of love, creator of heaven and earth, we are filled with gratitude for the blessings of this life, for making us in your image to love and care for one another. We give you thanks. For the gift of Christ who redeems and guides us and who gives us a pattern for everyday living, we praise you. For the work of the Spirit who works in us, through us, and beyond us, we praise you. Hear us now as we pray for situations where your love and grace are sorely needed. We pray for the church in this place and around the world, facing so many new challenges to respond in so many enduring needs. We pray for this beautiful planet, the fragile home we share with all living things, for children and youth who worry about the future of the planet and their place in that future, for those who govern in this area and the nations of the world, that they may find the wisdom and courage to do justice for all in all their decisions, for the homeless and the hungry, for the unemployed and the uncertain, for all who struggle with daily decisions for their families and their future, for those who mourn, for those who face illness or isolation, for all whose situations we carry on our hearts this day, we pray to you silently now, Lord. God, with us, we thank you for your all-embracing love that touches all life, each life, and keeps us in communion with those dear to us who now live with you. We join our voices to theirs in gratitude as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us join in our closing hymn number 650, He Leadeth Me, 650.
Amen.
The Apostle Paul teaches that we owe no one anything but to love one another. So with God's love in our hearts, to share that love with everyone you meet. And so may God, the source of life, Christ, the face of love in action, and the Spirit, the transforming power of love, and move through you. God bless you and bless God's world. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. Amen.